So my name is Pam Newbery. I'm with the League of Women Voters. Welcome. The League of Women Voters of Santa Cruz County presents Living on a Changing Coastline, Adapting to Predicted Sea Level Rise in Santa Cruz County. This is a free educational event. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization that encourages informed and active participation in government. Our mission is to influence policy through education and advocacy. League membership is open to women and men and all genders of all ages. Our league is funded by donations, and while this is a free event, you note that there's a donation box at the back of the room. Should you feel so inclined, we'd welcome any donations you'd like to make to defray the cost of this event and to help us present future events. I'd like to start with a very important bit of business. I'd like everyone to get out their cell phone right now and check to make sure it's set to silence, because no one wants to be the one scrambling to turn off their phone when it goes off during the presentation. Our format today will begin with the speaker's presentation, followed by a question and answer period. We ask that you hold your questions for after the presentation. This educational program is part of our local league study to consider updating our position on land use to reflect the effects of climate change and adapting to sea level rise. We'll conclude our program today with a brief discussion of the issue. At that point, members of the league are asked to remain for the discussion and consensus. That'll just be like the last 10 minutes of the meeting. Others may stay to observe or leave as they choose. On the topic of climate change and planning for sea level rise, our speaker, Ross Clark, is very well versed. He's majored in aquatic biology at UC Santa Barbara and followed up with a master's degree in marine ecology at Moss Landing Marine Laboratories. And as an environmental scientist for the California Coastal Commission, and in his current job as director of the Central Coast Wetlands Group, Ross's focus has been on improving water quality and wetland restoration. He's also a member of the County Commission on the Environment and the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Research Activity Panel. He writes a monthly environmental science feature for the Santa Cruz Sentinel. Since 2007, he has been working with the City of Santa Cruz to develop their strategic plan for reducing greenhouse gas emissions and has coordinated their sustainability team. He has studied coastal vulnerabilities from sea level rise and worked with Santa Cruz County and the cities of Watsonville, Capitola, and Santa Cruz to determine what adaptive actions should be taken to prepare for rising oceans. Welcome, Mr. Ross Clark.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And to clarify, I retired from the City of Santa Cruz last September, and luckily had Tiffany Wise West over there ready to take over the climate action program for the city. So if you have any mitigation questions or other questions, please ask her, because she knows what's going on, and I'm really thrilled to see the new energy and the new drive that the City of Santa Cruz is taking to reduce our impacts on the climate. But today I'm going to talk about the inevitable impacts due to carbon emissions for the last 150 years. Again, I'm from Moss Landing Marine Labs, and I have worked with the Monterey County and Santa Cruz County and Capitola on this project. It is a Ocean Protection Council funded grant to evaluate local hazards associated with sea level rise and climate change along our coastline, and then look at some of the adaptive options we have to address those future risks. So I'll be talking a little bit today and a quick outline. First and foremost, the climate is changing. End of discussion. Projected coastal climate hazards are significant, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. We are past weather, climate change is happening, but now trying to understand what our future looks like and how we can be smart about adapting to those changes. I'd also like to have or provide some ideas on different adaptation options and then have a discussion with all of you on what those different adaptations look like and which ones seem to be favorable to the community. And then most importantly, I'm here today to encourage public participation in this dialogue moving forward. This is the first time I've given this presentation. We just finished the data analysis. I am planning on presenting these findings to various others, other groups, but keep in mind that some of the data are still preliminary and they haven't been fully vetted by the technical team. That's happening as we speak, but don't quote me on any single number, but the overall evaluation is solid. Sound good? All right, so first and foremost, sea level rise. Can we make the screen brighter? Oh, can we turn that light off? Oh, is that better? Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Also,
there you go.
That's good.
Okay. So, back to mitigation, which is the reduction of greenhouse gases to minimize future impacts. This first graph here shows the importance of continuing to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. These are three slopes of sea level rise projections through to 90 years or so from now. And you can see that there are three different curves. Each of those curves is based on an assumed amount of carbon that we emit into the atmosphere over the next 100 years. The lowest curve is if we take significant and immediate actions. The middle curve is that we accomplish a lot, but not everything we want. And the top one is business as usual. And unfortunately, globally, we're following the red line right now. United States, and especially Santa Cruz, we are showing reductions, and that's why we're talking about this right now, to share the fact that we can get to one of those two lower curves if we want to, and I'll be talking about why that sounds like a good idea moving forward. We took these models that were generated globally, then for California, and then transition down to California, and then to the Central Coast. And we looked at three scenarios over three different time horizons for 2030, 2060, and 2100. And I'll present what these climate models predict for each of those time horizons moving forward. And of course, 2030 is right around the corner, so it'll be interesting to see what that looks like. We also looked at cliff erosion, coastal flooding, rising tides for this study. We also did river flooding for Capitola and Moss Landing, but I won't talk much about that today. So I start with a map like this, which I call the Maps of Doom. And this is, there's a great website here if any of you want to play around. It's through the Nature Conservancy that has all of the modeled layers showing where water is predicted to flood in the future under any one of those climate scenarios. You can go online and look at anywhere in the Monterey Bay as well as Santa Barbara and Ventura and see what it looks like. It's really interesting to do that. But I show this as an example of what those maps look like and then pose the question, what does that mean? And my answer is, well, that looks like a lot of stuff is happening and I don't know where to start and I don't know what to say about it, so I'm probably going to ignore it. And I've shown maps like this to many people, and a lot of people take that approach. It's like, well, it's too much for me to deal with. I don't really understand it, so I'm not going to worry about it. But what our project did is extrapolate out what these maps mean as far as where we live, where we shop, where we drive, etc., and then try and quantify those results. On the right over here, we have a quantified number of buildings that are within these flood zones for the different time horizons, 2010, 2030, 2060, and 2100. 2010 was our time zero, and you can see that even now there are buildings and infrastructure that are vulnerable to coastal flooding. Of course, we know that. We just lived through a winter of that. Also, disclaimer, I think I said it already, these are models and they're intended to help us with planning and they're not, all the data haven't been fully vetted, but the final reports will be available soon on our websites, and there'll be one for Capitola, Moss Landing, and then both counties of Monterey and Santa Cruz. Then I'm also working with Tiffany at the City of Santa Cruz to help do a further analysis for the city as well. So we can take those maps and then quantify what resources are predicted to be impacted in some way. And we can make tables like this showing the incremental increase in infrastructure that will be at risk. Still, it doesn't tell us very much about what do we do with this. And so that's that was the observation we had when we started looking at these combined data. And the focus of our study was, let's disaggregate these generalities and really look at what these models predict so that we and others can start making some good decisions on how to respond to these hazards. So here are some of the underlying effects of sea level rise and increased storm intensity that's predicted for the future. We have our cliff erosion, which we know very well in this part of the state. We're also in Monterey, see a lot of dune erosion issues, both of which are exacerbated when the oceans rise. The water is higher, hits the back of the cliffs more often. It increases the rate of erosion into the future. We also have rising tides. I think most people, when they think of sea level rise, this is the big threat. And we'll see whether that lays out as true moving forward. But you can see even now during king tide, some of our roads are inundated for hours to days. And then, of course, storm flood impacts. We've seen a lot of those over the last years. This is Capitola from a few years ago, but we had our intrepid city staff out there this winter trying to protect the community from waves impacts, and they actually did a really good job. Oh, one more thing. I want to point out that when we disaggregate these various hazards, you can also identify that some are temporary, like storm floods and river flooding happen during an event, and then you can recover from them, repair, and move on. The question is, how often do those effects occur in the future? And that's one of the uncertainties that we just really don't know still. Then there are permanent impacts, like tidal inundation. If this happens every month, you're really not going to redo your carpet every month when this happens. Also, when your cliff erodes, it's pretty much a permanent impact. By disaggregating each of those impacts, erosion, rising tides, and coastal storm flooding, and then looking at different parts of our communities individually, you can start to see some interesting information. One, different assets within our community, be it land use or infrastructure or industry, are vulnerable to different hazards at different times. You can see that erosion, and the dark blue is 2030, and you have 2060 and 2100, adding for each of these. So the lightest is what is predicted to be impacted by 2100. But you can see for 2030, erosion is, as far as impacts to homes, is not super significant, mainly because we have a lot of seawalls already in place protecting those homes. You can see, however, that coastal storm flooding currently is a larger hazard, and we've seen that recently. You can also look at dunes and wetlands, our natural habitats, and see that wetlands are, well, of course, they do flood, but they are more vulnerable to changes in that flooding regime having to do with salt or amount of time they're flooded. Dunes are also predicted to be vulnerable to erosion. And then I don't know how many people think about farmland, but you can see coastal flooding is a significant hazard for our low-lying farming areas. And then, of course, we have our roads and our rail, which are also in many places vulnerable to both erosion and coastal flooding. So let's delve in a little bit to one each of those different hazards and see what it looks like in time and space. First thing we can see is that for much of the coast, rising tides are not a large hazard. They don't pose threats to significant infrastructure everywhere, but in some low-lying areas like the Pajaro Valley, you can see significant risk associated with rising tides. And you can see over here that we have a few residential, and this is a logarithmic scale, so you have 10, 100. Few residential homes and few commercial are vulnerable to rising tides. But if you move over into farmland and look at our roads and our infrastructure, you start to see that there's a significant amount of resources in harm's way as predicted by the 2030 maps. You can also see large areas where we have low-lying areas and we don't really have the resources to manage these predicted floods. Storm flooding, which is caused, is exacerbated by sea level rise into the future, as well as an increase, predicted increase in the intensity of winter storms. As oceans warm up, the intensity of the storm is predicted to also increase. The combined effect of those two factors leads to bigger waves hitting our coast and flooding further inland. Again, you can see that coastal flooding is a little bit more uniform hazard along our coastline, and this is the Rio del Mar area. And then you can zoom into the low-lying areas of Rio del Mar and see that waves crashing over our current seawalls are predicted to become more and more of a flooding hazard into the future, and we start to see significant amounts of residential and commercial properties that are vulnerable. Now, this isn't news to Rio del Mar or to Capitola. They've had flooding in the past. These predictions, however, show that the amount of infrastructure vulnerable increases over time. And then again, the other question is how more frequently are these types of large storms going to occur in the future? And that really hasn't been modeled yet. So that's an uncertainty we don't know about. Risks from coastal erosion. In Santa Cruz County, this is a big concern. We built out along our coastline. Remarkably, in Monterey County, it's much less of a concern because we have a large set of dunes down there and haven't built as aggressively along the coastline. But you can see here that this is the East Cliff area, and if you zoom in, you can see different homes that are predicted to be vulnerable at different times into the future. We have taken into account all of the dotted lines are existing armoring that are currently in place, and we got this GIS layer from the Coastal Commission, who has been maintaining a really good record. But you can see that into the future, predicted erosion is a concern, and where coastal armoring currently does not exist is where buildings are most vulnerable soonest. For these models, though, we did take one assumption into our predictions, which is that by 2060, the current seawalls that are there will have given up their all, and their lifespan will have been far over. So somewhere between 2030 and 2060, we as a community or individuals as homeowners are going to have to make a policy decision on whether we replace those seawalls in the same location, or we take some other adaptive strategy moving forward. So that's why we have predicted erosion and impacts to individual homes at 2060 and 2100, because we have said that those seawalls will no longer exist there as they are. That helps us when we start to interpret different adaptation strategies. We can look at cost benefit, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. Our analysis has also helped with some of the communities identify critical infrastructure that may be vulnerable in the future, and specifically, when are those vulnerabilities predicted and what are the hazards that they are vulnerable for. And you can see that, well, the fire station and the police station are vulnerable to river flooding, and there's the fire station right there. So that's not new news, but it it does put it into perspective that that's not a once in a lifetime event. That is something that's predicted to occur in the future as well. We can also look at some of our historic districts and start to see what valuable, unique components of our community are at risk moving forward, because those are important considerations when we start looking at where do we invest our resources to protect or adapt to these hazards moving forward. And then taking all of those data and making some gross assumptions about valuation per unit as an average, we can generate overall valuations of the resources that are predicted to be vulnerable in the future. Now, as I mentioned, a home that gets flooded with a foot or two of water during a storm is not a complete loss. Whereas a home that is impacted by erosion, a cliff erosion, and has to be removed, that is a complete loss. We didn't do that level of analysis here. We just assumed every property that was identified in a hazard zone was a complete loss. We hope to change that in the future, but these numbers do help put into perspective what kinds of cumulative value or replacement costs we as a community are going to be faced with as we move forward. Already we have $500 million worth of properties which are within the current hazard zones. As we move forward by 2030, it increases slightly. And then between 2030 and 2060, it increases significantly by $700 million. Of course, that is partly because we are assuming those seawalls are gone. So taking the seawalls, the 7 or 8 miles of seawalls we have in this county, and if we don't replace them, we're going to it's going to be a cost of about $700 million in property that we lose because that is because of that policy or economic decision. You can also see that significant public infrastructure, roads, highways, rail, as well as storm drains, drinking water, are all in harm's way as well. Nice thing about many of these is we have redundant systems, and we can use secondary roads or other piping. But those decisions, it would be good to start talking about how to redefine where we want our infrastructure in the future before we get to the point of an emergency response. Anyway, by the end of 2100, with no armoring along the coastline, we have over $2 billion in resources at risk within this county, which is significant. And this is just the county. This is not in the incorporated cities. At the bottom here, if we want to protect all of the infrastructure that's currently that's predicted to be vulnerable, we would need to build about 8 miles of new seawalls sometime soon after 2060. And the estimated cost of doing that in today's dollars would be $410 million. So a significant amount of investment to protect more, but not significantly more in value. So these are some of the, taking some of these data and looking at them as a community, we can start to say, are these good investments, or do we need to look at different ways to adapt to these hazards? So, as I said, we have 4 reports coming out in the very near future, and I just pulled out a couple of the findings. We have a page or so of key findings for each of these communities, but for but some of them, coastal access, parking, commercial and residential buildings are vulnerable to wave damage currently, and more so by 2030 within the low-lying sections of Santa Cruz. That's fairly understandable. An additional 1,000 buildings are at risk of impacts by 2060 as these coastal armoring starts to fail. So we see a large increase in hazards as our current infrastructure stops providing that protective service. If all coastal armoring is replaced and additional structures are constructed to protect all buildings within the erosion zone, we would need to have about 12 miles of Santa Cruz County armored by 2060. That's a big number. By 2100, 1,800 residential properties are vulnerable for a total of $1.75 billion. Here's one, the highway along the North Coast. If we want to keep that highway in Santa Cruz County in the same place it is now, we'd need over 3 miles of new armoring just to protect the highway. That might be an easy decision to start with. So what do we do about those predicted hazards? What is our arsenal of adaptation strategies that we can look to and start hopefully making some smart decisions based on these data as well as others? There are many reports and discussing the various types of response, from hold the line, protect everything at all cost, to allow things to be removed as impacts occur, to improving our dune habitat or beach nourishment or other innovative, we call them soft, protective strategies, and then also regulatory tools and planning tools. Maybe we stop putting things, new infrastructure in harm's way, and we look at these hazard maps as a hint where we should either build things differently or not build things at all moving forward. So let's look at some of those. Top graph here is kind of what coastal retreat looks like from a homeowner on the cliff side. And of course, you know, as that begins, you're going to want to put a bunch of rock right up there to keep that process from the cliff's erosion from basically taking your property. What also happens, though, is as the tides rise, you begin to lose your beach in front of that cliff, which in California is public property. So now we have a conflict where private property owners or municipal or public infrastructure, there's a desire to protect it where it is, and one of the costs in addition to construction is the actual loss of part of our beach, which is an important resource that we all value. Below is one example of what that may look like more and more. This is Capitola. You can see that the west side of the town, they have put up a lot of riprap to protect the wall, which then protects the road and the parking and the railroad and then houses behind it. And one of the effects of that is what we call coastal squeeze, where the back shore is solid, the ocean is rising and migrating inland, and what happens is that our beach or our transition areas are the thing that continue to shrink until we have no beach at all. And I'll show you some predictions of that moving forward. So I'm going to look at a couple of different hazards and then think about what are some of the adaptation options, and then show you a couple that we've already begun to implement, some happy parts of the story. This is East Cliff again, and as it sits now. And you can see that we have lots of armoring along this coastline. But then we also have some sections where we haven't armored yet. And then you can see one or two little red houses, which are predicted to be vulnerable by 2030. So those homes are going to want to protect themselves in the in the very near future. 10 years from now, there may be proposals to go in and put seawalls up to protect those properties. And then, of course, the properties next to them are going to want to do the same thing, because seawalls cause affects upstream or up coast and down coast. So it becomes a progression till the point where we may have a wall all along this area. Considerations. We have about 10 miles of replacement or new within the bay armoring that we're going to need to put in at $20 to $50 million a mile. That's a lot. And then, of course, we're also in many cases using public resources to protect private property. Here's a GIS analysis that we did, taking a approach where we assumed that we are going to hold the line anywhere where there is a property that is vulnerable. We are going to assume that a wall will have been put up there to protect the property. And what the red, orange, and yellow show is time horizons when there will be no usable beach left for that area. And you can see, well, of course, West Cliff and East Cliff, much of it, there isn't beach now, except for pocket beaches here and there. That's partly natural, but it's also exacerbated by riprap and armoring. But you can see as we move into 2060 and 2100, some of our most valuable beach areas become susceptible to coastal squeeze. And then so our children's children will say, hey, let's go to the beach. And they have two options. You know, they can either go to over by the harbor or down to Manresa. Because if we protect everything as by holding the line, and we are going to be losing much of our usable beach within the Monterey Bay portion of the county. So that's a real concern. How do we address that? And I don't have the answer, but I'll show you what some thoughts are and what that looks like on a map. So we're back to our map. We can see that there are some areas where there isn't armory now. So I zoom in a little bit closer over here, and let's say we take on the lower blue blob the approach that we shouldn't have any new armoring. Let's not have new armoring in areas that haven't already been armored. Well, that little area there will progress, erosion will progress inland. We will lose some homes, but we may have a very nice pocket beach. Okay, that's a policy. Of course, the houses on either end are going to want to put seawalls along the side to protect their side their property as well. There you go. Let's go up one blue blob. And many policies suggest, well, as your land erodes inland, maybe you move your house inland. And it's like, okay, well, I moved that little house all the way to the road. That's great. I don't need a seawall. But what we have is an area where you have erosion continuing inland with hard walls on either side. Again, the neighbors are going to want to put up walls on both sides. And you've got, I wouldn't call that a pocket beach as much as a ramp for waves. Go up one more, and well, maybe we just take the house down because we, or worse, the property owner says, I can't afford the wall here, I'm just going to walk away from the property. And so we have a property where it is condemned, the house is taken down, and erosion increases inland unmanaged. Those are, I think, real potential scenarios. None of which are being accomplished based on prioritization or planning from the community. And that's what I'm here to talk a little bit about today, is how can we do better than that? How can we not, I call it the Swiss cheese approach to coastal armoring. You know, do we really want holes here and there along our coastline, or do we really want to think about policy and management in a way that protects our resources and ensures that we don't have to go to Manresa to go to the beach? So this is kind of my mock-up of what, you know, a bunch of us could sit around a table and say, what do we want our coastline to look like in 2060? And some areas we may say, well, these are heavily populated areas with lots of homes along the coast that we allowed to build there. We allowed them to protect them. Well, maybe that's where we continue erosion management into the 2060 and further, and we hold the line. But then we can also say, well, there are other areas where we really want to protect our beaches. And so we have our beach preservation areas, and you know, down at Main Beach and near Capitola and East Cliff and a couple of Rio Del Mar. We say for these areas, we're going to come up with a set of policies that ensure that our beach is protected, and whether how we implement that based on the implications to public and private properties is something we'll of course have to discuss and decide whether it's cost effective or not. But at least we're starting to plan that we don't want one beach at the South County. We want to preserve our infrastructure, but also our beaches as well. And then I also threw in coastal resources. We have surfing spots we may want to consider, what this armoring does on them long term. We have our harbor, we have our river, we have our lagoons. All of these considerations are things that we might want to put on this map and say, in these areas we want to take natural resources or coastal resources into consideration as we adapt our management planning process. So now that's kind of a thought of regional planning. I'll go back to that in a little bit. But right now I want to show you what adaptation based on one of these risk hazards may look like, and some early success in doing that, even though the primary objective was not to adapt to sea level rise. We're doing it anyway. So here we go. This is Moss Landing, and we have the harbor, Elkhorn Slough, Castroville down at the bottom, and all the shaded gray area are the incredibly rich farmlands of the Lower Salinas Valley, which are an important economic driver of the region, and employ lots of people, and grow great artichokes. But you can see that even now, these areas are they're extremely low, and they're beginning to be vulnerable to sea level rise, and some of them are currently vulnerable to flooding. The blue shaded area is a relief showing where by 2030 the elevation of those areas will be within the tidal zone. Now I do want to put in that we have two tide gates, one here and one here, that restrict the height of the tides, and those were put in specifically to accommodate that. How long those will work moving into the future is a question that we're looking at doing some river fluvial hydrology analysis, which gets pretty complicated. But for now, we just want to look at these are some of the risks to part of our industry. As we move to 2060, you can see that more low-lying areas are vulnerable to flooding. And then by 2100, you can see much of the Lower Salinas Valley is vulnerable. If we go to the high extreme predicted sea level rise, you can see that much of the Lower Salinas Valley is predicted to be underwater by 2100. And you can see the incremental acreage associated with those increases over time. As I said, there are structures in place to minimize this, but how well they'll work while still also allowing river water to flow through is in question. So here I want to show you this and show you that adaptation is possible. This is our unofficial managed retreat strategy for the Lower Salinas Valley. And each one of those numbers there is an acquisition or an easement agreement that we at Moss Landing Marine Labs and the Central Coast Wetlands Group or Elkhorn Slough Foundation has made with a farmer and is in some kind of resource management or restoration currently. You can see that we've been working since 1995 out there when I was a graduate student. And over time, we have acquired and are now restoring significant parts of the low-lying areas that's vulnerable to sea level rise, not as a mandate, but as a working relationship with the farmers. And it's been very successful. And one of the reasons I moved to over to the coast, the Central Coast Wetlands Group completely was to complete the 2016 wetland restoration right there in the middle, which is now up and running, and it's really cool. You should go out there. It's right north of Castroville, and it's full of water. You can see it from the highway. But you can see that this wasn't a sea level rise adaptation strategy, but we've been seeing the signs of sea level rise impacts and working with the industry to say, how do we help you transition from these being used lands to something that is also valuable? And from our perspective, having a restored wetlands is a valuable transition. So I'm really thrilled that we've been able to accomplish this type of work. And I, you know, as these tide predictions continue, of course there's going to be more opportunities, and I actually have a couple of question marks out there of, you know, those are properties we're talking friendly with the farmers about maybe doing next. So those were tides. As we talked earlier, coastal storm flooding is an earlier and more significant temporary impact. It's not going to happen every month on the high tide, but during large storm events, you can see significant inland flooding as ocean waves drive inland. And this is the 2060 hazard map for the Lower Salinas area, and you can see significant amounts of ocean-derived flooding all the way past Castroville. And as, let's see if it's here. Yeah, as I mentioned before, we have some protections in place currently. We have a levee down at the river. We have the Potrero tide gates, which I mentioned before, which restrict ocean waters from coming into the Salinas Valley. And then we have a very important but underappreciated third part of that protective strategy, which is our coastal dunes between Moss Landing and the river mouth. And a report that we did in 2013 noted the importance of these natural barriers to coastal impacts to the entire Salinas Valley. We also noted that significant parts of those sand dunes are covered in invasive ice plant, which compromises the dune's ability to move with changes in sea level and sand availability, and basically hardens them in place and makes them less resilient to the impacts that we're predicting. The red line over here is the 2100 erosion line predicted. You can see that for this section, there we're predicting that there will be no dune habitat unless we encourage the dunes to migrate naturally for this part of the system, leaving much of the Salinas Valley vulnerable to storm flooding. So we took it on ourselves to come up with a pilot project to address this hazard. And here's our theoretical process. Natural dunes are a gentle slope. You reduce the energy of the waves as it goes up the slope and hits the various plant communities. When you have ice plant, the ice plant causes these very secure very steep-fronted dunes. The waves have no can come crashing up and undercut those dunes, removing the sand, and then you have catastrophic failures of the foredune. And this is kind of the, what the steep foredune looks like with ice plant on it. And that's one of the issues that we're trying to address here, is to get rid of the ice plant, propagate native plants that help build the foredune in a much more gradual slope that helps eliminate some of that wave energy. The other thing we're looking at is you can see this trail coming out to the beach. And most people like to walk through sand as little as possible, so they go straight from the parking lot straight out to the beach. What that does is generates these scours that are great little funnels for waves to come shooting up in and overtopping the dunes, causing additional erosion and becoming the ramp for that future flooding. So we're trying to work with state parks to change the angle of some of those pathways so they're not facing into the waves, so we don't have that vulnerability. And this is a little bit of what that's looking like right now. Let's see, it's cut off at the bottom, but the funding for this is through the Coastal Conservancy, provided us funding last year. We are out killing the ice plant and bringing in kids and the public to plant native plants in places where the ice plant has died, and hoping to get to reform these more gradual slope dunes on the right. These are some bunches of straw that helped to accumulate sand on that foredune. But you can see how we're trying to restore habitat, but then also increase the resiliency of the natural habitat. And we have researchers at Moss Landing Marine Labs studying how these dunes will build over time. Very important information if we want to replicate this kind of natural adaptation up and down the coast, is to have the data to show how well it works, and so that others can feel that that the data provide a level of certainty that if they adopt this practice, they'll see success as well. So those are two adaptation projects that are currently underway. What can we do more locally here in Santa Cruz? And I have a couple of ideas in the last couple minutes here. What do we do between now and 2030? First and foremost, let's not put more things in harm's way. And let's start with our municipal and publicly owned infrastructure. If we're going to put something somewhere, let's make sure that it won't be vulnerable, and it, either by the design or the placement of that structure, it won't be within compromised by the hazards that have been predicted for 2030. We can also look at building standards and individuals that want to build properties. Well, let's build them in ways that are resilient to the predicted hazards that we now know. Makes sense. We should be improving our resiliency to flooding along the river and the coast. Flooding is the number one short-term hazard that we've identified for much of our infrastructure. And so we should really take a focus on how we can increase our resiliency to that as soon as possible. One way to do it is upgrade our storm drains. Some storm drains can be a conduit, allowing floodwaters to come inland further through a pipe and bubble up in the middle of town. And we've seen that in some areas of some of our low-lying areas. So that's something to work with public works departments to identify which are may provide that conduit, and then redesign them so that it doesn't occur. Let's start talking about how we prioritize coastal protection, upgrades, and replacement. You know, everybody, of course, will want to protect their property, at least until they see how much it's going to cost. Let's start talking about what the cumulative effect of those individual actions is, and if that's not the desired outcome, let's come up with some alternative strategies on how to move forward. And then beach nourishment, of course, is something that's been brought up different studies and different groups as a short-term option to reduce that impacts over the short term, at least. Moving further into the future, I see this as the time when smart planning is going to do us very well. We need to identify priority areas for future protection, accounting for cost, structural feasibility, and secondary implications. Those being, of course, loss of beach and habitat. We should be thinking about all of those issues in total now, so that we're not responding to emergency situations indefinitely. We need to identify priority areas for managed retreat to retain sufficient beach area for recreational use, and understand what kinds of programs we need to put in place to accommodate the landowners that may find themselves in such a designated area. And then further in, we need to actually implement the managed retreat strategies that we've set into place. And it would be nice for people to understand what those are far before they're going to be implemented, so that property valuation and individual investments can understand what is to come into the long-term future. And then, of course, we're going to really need to start looking at how to realign municipal infrastructure that it probably is not worth the price to protect it. It's easier and cheaper to actually move it. So that's kind of my first run through of this. It's a lot of information, but hopefully I was able to tell a story. Thank you. Possible first steps moving forward, I have just a couple. Support your local climate action program. Tiffany is here, and the county has a climate action program, as does Capitola and other municipalities. They're doing great work with limited resources, and those resources are there because the community has spoken that this is important, continuing to remind decision makers that climate action and climate mitigation is the number one priority, is something that leads to new resources and success. We need to review sea level rise hazards and know what to do with them. We need to discuss impacts and implications along the coast. We need to understand the costs of adaptation, and then consider the secondary impacts of those adaptation strategies. And these are all things that I think the public should be versed in and be part of the conversation on. And then I personally put a plug in for we really need to strive for equitability in our strategy forward, because there are public and private stakes at hand, and those all need to be respected, and we need to come up with, I think, the most cost-effective way to get to what we want the coast to look like by 2060. Finally, I'd like to note that one way that you can get part of this dialogue soon is that the City of Santa Cruz has their hazard mitigation plan up for review. It's on the city's website right now, and that is the primary document that outlines what the city plans to do to respond to various hazards and climate issues. The city had the first climate adaptation plan adopted by FEMA in California, and one of the first in the nation, I believe. So the city's far in front on this planning, but now it's time to renew it. It's 5 years later. Your input on what those plans look like and what we want the coast to look like by 2060, that's the first place to voice your opinion. How's that, Tiffany? Is that right? Thank you.
You can access that from the main page of our homepage under news. There's an invitation to the public to review the local hazard mitigation plan and provide comments.
So that's my end of my presentation. Questions? comments? Yes.
Could you go back to the first slide that you showed that had the three curves?
The first, oh yes.
Yellow, orange, red. I wanted to ask you a question.
Yeah, let's get into the science. Where is it?
Yeah, that one.
Yep.
The numbers on the right-hand side, 41, I can't quite read the rest of it.
That is the centimeters increase in ocean predicted ocean levels under those three different emissions scenarios for 2100. So 159 centimeters is about this tall, right? That's how you know you look. You go step down to the water, by the boardwalk, and you turn around, and your eye level is pretty much where the high emissions prediction is for sea level rise, and figure out where you're looking, and that's where it's going to be.
Yeah, going along that question, when you talked about the urban sector afterwards, which model did you use, a low, medium, or high model?
Good, very good question. For the 2030, which is our is coming up quick, we use this middle emissions level. I've already said that globally we're up above this one, but we adopted this number for 2030. But then we did move to the high value for 2060 and 2100. That's provides a certain level of predictive. It gives us a certain level of uncertainty. We acknowledge that throughout our reports, but these are hazard areas. These aren't hazard certainties, and for a modeling process, that's what the community suggested that we do.
I have one more follow-up question, and I don't see anything about what happens to the groundwater, the fresh groundwater, rising sea level.
Certainly, groundwater interactions are complex, but when you have oceans increasing along the coast, there's an increase in saltwater pressure inland, both on the surface and within the groundwater. And then, of course, that is all dependent on how much pumping of our groundwater, changes in rainfall, et cetera. All of those things become a very dynamic interaction. But predictions for rain are that it's going to be flashier, more intense, but more infrequent, which it does not support effective groundwater recharge in the same way as the more metered out rain over a longer period of time. So between higher seas and more infrequent flashy rain does not pose well for groundwater.
I know this is a local thing, but you're probably the best qualified person I know to answer maybe a question related to that. And that is, we're looking at all these disaster scenarios and how much it would cost us to understand. But is there any research at all as to what it would cost to not have any of these disaster scenarios, even on a worldwide basis?
I would love it if I could find those numbers. In 2009, the Pacific Institute did the first fairly comprehensive analysis of sea level rise impacts in California, and they have some overall numbers by county on the amount of infrastructure vulnerable. So that's a good number for California, maybe, but globally, the point's taken that we're hearing a lot of comments from Washington D.C. right now about how it's not a good investment to have high efficiency vehicles or invest in solar and things. And it's like, well, we have data to show that from our local community, it's a very important and significant investment if we can mitigate some of those actions. And if we can drop from the red to the orange, we'll see significant reductions in the amount of local impacts. So I think that's a very smart investment. Go.
You can see the lines are getting steeper as they go up to the right. And I wonder who, if anyone, is providing leadership on looking beyond 2100.
I'm not certain. I mean, these are all kind of run through the the UN's climate program. Yeah, thank you. And so they're really doing the leadership. I'm not sure how many people are doing models and how robust they are. I know some people are looking at 500 years out, but for most of the adaptation and hazard studies, we're just sticking with this time frame because that's a couple of generations of general plans and land use plans and things like that. So that's kind of gives us some information to set short, medium, and long as being, you know, 80 years from now goals. But yeah, we're really not looking at 500 years out, but those curves do continue to go
six
up for,
yeah. Plan for.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Speaking of longer time horizons, I might have missed this at the beginning, but those curves probably don't assume the wild cards, namely large chunks of Antarctica or Greenland cracking off within that century. But do you know if that's any probability of that?
They do not take into account those inputs from, you know, either of those land-based.
As we now know, there are some chunks that look like they're ready to do something.
Yes. And I think there was one estimate that if all of Greenland melted, it'd be a 21-foot increase in ocean levels globally.
My concern is about the armoring. Mm-hmm. You talked about armoring the coast. And the armoring that we have right now, which was probably a bad idea because of the unintended consequences. In terms of armoring or not continuing to armor, you talked about the recreational use of beaches, where we would want to have our beaches. Will there be any consideration given to the fact that we are the Pacific flyway for migratory birds who have been around longer than human beings, and that every time we lose a beach, we lose a feeding and resting resource for those birds who cannot make their 3,000 to 6,000 mile migrations without that, and that maybe that should be factored in terms of policy decisions by either the city or county, not so much for our recreation, but that we have a responsibility to migratory birds, including the international treaties that protect them. Mm-hmm. Is the city or county going to be looking at that, or is it going to be strictly human use of
this work is primarily for infrastructure costs and human focus, but a partner publication from the Nature Conservancy did some great work, and Dr. Walter Heddy at the Nature Conservancy did an analysis of ecological value of our beaches within the Monterey Bay and their susceptibility to these kinds of coastal squeeze that I describe, and looked at cost implications associated with impacts to birds and just the ecological value of the habitat as well. So that is quantified, and I think a really an interesting way. And those data can be overlaid with what we have here and say, okay, you know, I showed we should have a beach here. Didn't take into account the ecological services provided or the value to the local economy from having those beaches. We have other layers that we should of data we should take into account as we start having these discussions.
Can you find that online?
Yeah, the Nature Conservancy. It's a 2016 report for the Southern Monterey Bay, but they looked at beach ecology for the entire bay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
With the four incorporated communities in the county, and all the county land interspersed on the coast and back, is there a combined effort is agreed, or does, you mentioned Santa Cruz and there's Capitola, and they all these coastlines have different municipal governments, so is there complete cooperation?
There's significant discussions, which is a good start. And that was one of the intents of doing a Monterey Bay-wide report or set of reports for this project, was that we want to provide all of the different municipalities the same information so they can start comparing and understanding what their policy decisions mean within a larger context. So we're starting that dialogue. Is there full integration yet? Well, no, we haven't even gotten to, you know, what are some of our policy goals that we want to start from. Tiffany, did you have?
I was just going to say there is a regional adaptation collaborative that's forming amongst various municipalities and the county and so forth in our area. This is starting to be a much larger focus for the city, so we will be collaborating regionally as we are updating our adaptation plan and we'll have implementation this year.
And the focus reports we did for Capitola and Moss Landing, we delve into even more specifics and more adaptation options, and then try and extrapolate those out to the countywide reports. So we're looking at that, but it's a long process, and we're really early in that.
This, the rising oceans, are you talking about a lot of weather that's being generated these days? Rain that would lift the oceans, or are you talking about melting of the ice caps? Where is this rising?
The sea level rise? Mm-hmm. It's a combination of increased expansion of the oceans due to higher relative temperatures of the oceans, which is a significant component of it, and then melting of ice from that is currently on landforms, so it's not part of the Arctic ice sheet, which is part of the ocean. Currently, it is new water that's being contributed from melting ice.
I'm just going to mention a year ago in January of 2016, we had Gary Griggs and Michael Orbach talk about sea level rise and what's contributing to that. So we have a video of that. If you want to go to our website, lwbscc.org, under our video section, you can click on that and you can watch that presentation. It's very informative about exactly what's causing sea level rise. I mean, you know, cement, who thought? I mean, cement is a key component. That was one thing that surprised me, but there's a lot of information there.
Going back to locally down in Monterey County, the sand company down there that's selling sand, is there a time frame for that company to go away? And if they do, is there a restoration of a project that would go on?
I won't defer that question. Everyone knows that this, the study has been done showing that the sand mining just south of the Salinas River are contributing a significant component of coastal erosion between Salinas River and the city of Monterey. They haven't been able to shut them down now. I know the Coastal Commission has written some letters. I know that there's some legal actions going on, but they're an international corporation. I know that Surfrider has taken a lead in fighting their continued operations. Basically, if you don't know, they have part of their property which has a pond on it. It's above the high tide line, so it's not officially public land. Waves come over the top, bring sand in, they scoop it out, repeat. That is taking a significant amount of the sand coming from the Salinas River that naturally would migrate down coast out of our littoral cell that maintains some of the coastline down there. So it's causing the ocean to find other sediments to fill that void, which is causing further erosion of the coastline down there. Fortunately, we don't have 1,800 homes right through that area, but we do have some significant hotels and things, as well as the highway. They're all kind of vulnerable.
I ran into a little traffic coming here today from, I was out of town last couple of days, and I'm just wondering if any discussion has gone on in this context of the economic impact of tourism failing to have any beaches or boardwalks for people to come and play at.
Yeah. Economic implications are something that we can look at, and we're going to be working with the city with some of the overlays of these hazards on different designated tourist areas, et cetera, as well as socioeconomic groups to understand the relative implications of the impact predicted by those hazards on those parts of our economy or in our social network. So yes, we are looking at that.
So there will be less traffic coming.
Well, I'm banking on the rail to help us with that.
Have you heard any consideration of rail infrastructure being more resilient than highways?
To flooding?
Resilient in general, more resilient.
Well, the predictions for the rail are not moving in the future. Much of it is the hazards for the rail is from erosion on the sections that go very close to the cliff line, which is as a big proponent of rail for our community. That's something that needs to be considered. And are there are ways to move that infrastructure inland in the future? So the erosion, predicted erosion hazards for 2060 are big for parts, two or three sections of our rail in this county. Flooding of the rail is already a concern in Elkhorn, where the rail is only a foot or two above mean high tide. So during the king tides, it floods now. So they have to stop operations during those times. Yep, I used it up. but the rail company, as the tides increase, they just kind of lift the rail up. So they've.
Does that work?
It does to some degree.
There is some resiliency
there. I think the big challenge is the coastal erosion.
One of my big questions is the sewage treatment plant at Near Lagoon. Is it really practical that that's going to be protected, hardened and protected enough to keep it going through the end of the century? What are plans to replace it or move it?
I don't know. I do know that it is vulnerable to sea level rise, both from a groundwater as well as a surface water. My understanding is it's predicted that parts of the infrastructure may actually end up floating because of groundwater, and it was a $100 million project when it was installed. So it's an important part of our infrastructure that is in a very low lying area by design. Now, of course, the Pajaro wastewater treatment plant is within those flood areas that I showed you for the Pajaro Valley. Many of our wastewater treatment facilities are at the bottom, so that it all goes that way. So that's challenging. I've talked with some Stanford researchers that are working on new techniques for wastewater treatment, which is more distributed throughout a community, smaller pocket systems. Whether or not those are feasible and can meet all the environmental needs as far as smell and treatment efficiency and things like that will be seen as they continue their research, but it provides an option that we wouldn't have to take now $200 million infrastructure and lift it or move it. We may adapt by distributing that service throughout our community. It's an interesting idea, and it's that kind of identifying a challenge or a hazard or a risk and coming up with innovative ways to solve it or actually do better than protect it.
In coming up with the
property values early on. Did those property values assume an inflation in the value of the home at a future time, 15 years from now?
No, it's all 2016 numbers, and there's a lot of assumptions and a lot of fallacy in those numbers, but it was, I'm not an economist, but that was our first try, and we hope to work with the cities and the county to improve on that. We have the data on what kinds of infrastructure is vulnerable to what hazards, and then we can work with them to say, okay, that's a $50,000 hazard, whereas this is $1 million hazard, and then we can rerun those numbers and get better tables.
And a follow-up on that, did that include, I'm visualizing your slide of the coast, and there were, let's say, 20 properties that were vulnerable sitting out on the coast now. Mm-hmm. If those all went away as the coast went inland, it seems like there are more properties who would then be ocean view, and wouldn't their value go up? So you'd have more properties with higher value.
I think that that's the discussion we need to have. Yeah, is because you're right. The people across the street that don't have ocean view, maybe they have some right to have their chance, right? I think that's as fair a policy as any of the others that have been proposed, right? So, let's talk about it. And then, of course, the equitability factor is like somebody's losing their property and somebody's gaining value in theirs. How do we, how do we make that fair to some degree, right?
Is there a public obligation to protect any piece of property, or is that not a public obligation?
I know, having worked for cities, that they're very interested in maintaining the safety and the efficiency and the effective and the reliability of their infrastructure. So they want their sewers and storm drains and their roads and everything to be safe and work. So there is a compelling interest to continue to maintain that level of service. Whether or not that those services could be provided in a different location by moving or reallocating how that system works is totally feasible. I haven't seen very many communities that have said, made the decision that we're going to allow infrastructure to fail and move it elsewhere. Although I changed that answer, you do see that already. You see, Westcliff, there was a road out there, right? And Eastcliff, there was, we have little parts of the road, remnant roads, but we've lost a lot of that service. So in the past, we have allowed infrastructure to be lost and done fine. So whether or not that's the initial response, I don't think that is.
I was actually asking in relation to private property.
Oh, private property? Sure. Private property, I don't think so. I don't think, much of this seawall over here is all privately installed and maintained, which then leads to the haphazard nature of it, is you have 80 different design styles and looks out here of different ages, and your neighbors are relying on the continued success of your wall. So it's a hodgepodge of private projects that is providing now a community function. Whether that's the function that everyone in the community wants or not is beside the point. That's what we've got to. But no, a lot of these, the county is not required or committed to maintain. Now there are coastal access points along here that they are interested in maintaining. So there is infrastructure that that they have a vested interest in protecting.
All right. Thanks very much.
Thank you.